Are you hydrating every day? Well, our friends at Organifi, they believe in hydration with purpose. Introducing their superfood powder blends that turn your everyday water into a delicious, nutrient-packed drink. It's like a power boost from nature. One standout is their green juice, a personal favorite of ours for years. Unlike other green juices, it actually tastes great. Imagine enjoying a refreshing drink that's better than plain water and filled with incredible ingredients like chlorella, spirulina, and moringa from around the world. Just one scoop a day can make a massive difference for your body. What sets Organifi apart is the clinical dose of the adaptogen ashwagandha, known to balance cortisol levels, your stress hormone. In times of heightened stress, this can be a game changer for your weight, sleep, and your immune system. Organifi sources top quality ingredients from organic farms worldwide, ensuring their products are vegan friendly, gluten free, and free of any artificial additives. It's pure nutrition in every sip. All right, so here's the exciting part for you. Because you rock with the Secrets to Success podcast, you can go to Organifi.com/success and explore their collection. And at checkout, make sure you use the promo code SUCCESS for an exclusive 20% discount on all products. Yes, you heard it right. It's VIP treatment just for you. Discover how these superfoods can transform your health journey. Visit Organifi.com/success and use the promo code SUCCESS at checkout and experience it for yourself. Your satisfaction is guaranteed. Hydrate with purpose and elevate your well-being with Organifi Green Juice. Cheers to a healthier you.
Now listen, this is a true story. We was in the meeting, downtown Chicago, had the sky, we were overlooking a bunch of skyscrapers.
The skyscraper starts in your head first. I knew that was the next level for me, skyscraper. My only problem was I didn't have the knowledge. I didn't have the exposure of it. You can't do it on your own.
I just want to get my mind blown. Talk to me.
Coming from the South Mississippi to Chicago, migration, it's a hustle. Hey. I'm a bed man. I'm the computer man. I got an architecture degree. Can't find a job nowhere in Chicago. Bro, I can't do it.
There's no shortcuts, bro.
Black people are ahead of the white people in architecture.
And I'm like, man, a black man doing skyscrapers? So we could have built or developed a skyscraper anywhere. But we picked this community. This community, man, is a historically black community.
I have never in my life been more impressed.
I'm being billed for your time at $75 an hour. And we put air conditioning on the entire beach. I know my worth.
You ready? All right.
What's going on, world? Welcome to another edition of the Secret to Success podcast. I'm your host, CJ, joined, as always, Douglas. I'm going Douglas first today. Douglas, how you feeling, man?
Blessed, bro.
Now, I didn't even say it last time, but because I didn't want to ruin it, but obviously Carl is not here. He's attending to some very important matters, but we're going to get that,
that podcast, get
that full joint. It's coming. So, also, we got Dr. King in the building. Dr. King, what's happening?
Hey, man, living life, brother. Living life to the fullest.
I had a wonderful conversation with my younger brother over here, Justin Owens, J.O., new age CEO. He's back with us, man.
Let's go.
And we have another doctor.
Oh.
yeah, real another one. Doctor.
Put the some real respect.
The Let real me tell one. You something.
Some respect on
now. Listen, this is a true story. I don't know if Johnny remember this, and we're gonna introduce y'all to Dr. Johnny Mullins. But just so Maul had introduced me to Johnny, and I don't know what it was, but it was like a more of a corporate, like we were in the boardroom or something.
I remember when you first called about it.
Yeah,
it was like whoa.
And but look, so I was like, and let me tell you something. You know when a cat smart. Cause I know when cat's smart, cause I just be quiet. And we was in the meeting downtown Chicago, had the sky, we were overlooking a bunch of skyscrapers. First of all, I'm just getting really my feet wet with the real estate thing, so I'm not about to be in here just doing too much.
Waxing deep.
I know how to be self-assessed. Yeah. I know what I don't know. Yeah. I'm sitting in there, this man using terminology and words and stuff I never heard. He's got a nice clean look to him. We went to the next place where they working on developments and all kind of stuff. He using, I'm talking about smart. I'm talking about, I didn't even want to say nothing to my man. He was so smart. Maul had like a mixer at the house the next day. Johnny walked up on me and was like, what's up, C? Good to see you again. I was like, how you doing? I'm CJ. Nice to meet you. He was like, it's me. I said, who?
Dr. Mullen?
He was like, it's Johnny. I said, Johnny who? Bruh. Am I lying, Johnny?
Online.
I had no, because he had a fitted on. He had just like a hoodie, some sweats, and was like, yo, what's up? And he was like a bruh. And I was like,
he was like a bruh. Like,
no, bruh. No, listen, bruh. I was like, bruh. And I said, and Mar said, Johnny was, I said, the dude talking on crate, like, he was like, yeah, bruh. So anyway, just a hilarious start to, you know, my knowing Johnny.
And that's how I met him, just because you was talking like that.
Oh, no, 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 bruh, listen. Yeah.
So when I saw you the first time.
No, I'm not going to lie.
I was like, not thrown off.
Yeah.
But I was like, oh, okay, he really... From
Chicago. Oh, yeah, yeah, no, no, no. Chicago.
You feel me?
Yeah. So
he
anyway.
He had to show him, though.
I'm not going to steal the thunder. I'm going, you know, this is Maul's, you know, good friend and brother here, Johnny. You know, become a great friend to all of us. But Maul, I'll let you kind of take it in terms of, you know, how you met Johnny, what you working on, and then we'll just pop off a conversation just about.
Yeah, Maul brought that accent to us.
Yeah, go ahead. Yeah.
Bro, just to go back to that last podcast, we talking about, you know, certain people that you answer your phone for.
Yeah.
But this is one of them guys.
Yeah.
You know, we got some mutual friends and business associates of ours. They was, you know, they came to each one of us individually and was saying that they wanted to put together this development team to build this skyscraper. Mm. And I knew the guys I was working with, you know, a couple of them. And the only one I didn't know really was Johnny. And Johnny knew them, and the only one he didn't know was me. Mm. And so me and Johnny, we just like, you know, they talking about this Johnny Mullins. And I'm like, you know, who is this Johnny Mullins guy? I'm the 9-to-5 millionaire. Right. Who am 9-to-5 millionaire? Who
five
is this?
Levels.
You know what I'm saying?
Five levels.
Who is this guy?
With Justin. The key.
And then five levels.
And then, you know what I'm saying?
And two keys.
And Johnny over there, like, you know, man, who is this Jamal guy? And so me and Johnny, actually Damon, it's kind of like a mutual friend who, you know, Damon know Johnny, know me. He said, man, y'all two need to get together and just talk.
Shout out to Damon.
Shout out to Damon. Yeah. So then I never forget it. My first time meeting him, Damon brought him over to my house. And, you know, I took him on the fourth level, on the deck. I didn't let him get up to the fifth level yet. You know, you got to be.
Not on the first.
Yeah, we went to, I got to make sure you're good first.
Yeah, on the fourth.
So he went to the
keep
fourth.
Keep him at Justin level.
Don't Justin been the all the way up to the top, bro. Justin been up to the top. You know,
I've seen the mountaintop. You know,
yeah, we just, you know, I did my research on him first. And then when I started researching him, and Damon was already telling me a lot, I think at the time, you were one of the finalists, or you either got the contract with Google, I believe. And that was like a multi-billion dollar.
$11 billion.
Petty cash. He said that. He's like, take your little 9-to-5 millionaire.
Mom, when you say you did your research, did you call your cop friends and go on the computer? And...
Yeah, yeah.
I did my other research. Oh, I didn't do that. I didn't do that research. Oh, I did my research where I, you know, called my money friends.
Okay. Right.
And kind of just was seeing, you know, like, hey, you know, and then the more and more I was looking, and the more I kept talking to people, I started seeing people had a crazy respect for this guy. Wow. And I'm like, man, a black man doing skyscrapers?
Talking like that.
Yeah, a bruh that's from Chicago. You know, not, you know, went to Harvard and all this, but from Chicago.
Yeah.
And then me and Johnny, we talked, and instantly we saw that, like, all right, we got a lot in common. And it wasn't more so about real estate. It was more just personalities.
Absolutely.
And just... You know, just, you know, that Chicago style. You know, when you meet somebody from Chicago,
no,
you just kind of like that
click. Yeah, it's a thing.
And then we end up bonding. And then, man, make a long story short, man, after that, a lot of other development opportunities came about, and the two of us have partnered together. And he's brought so much value to the team.
Oh, no
Because
question.
You know how everybody always know, I talk about your level of exposure determines your level of success. Yeah. It's not that... You know, we on that level now where we on legacy.
Yeah.
You know, everything that we do, if it ain't moving the letter, and I told Johnny that, like, when we first got together, I'm like, bro, even Johnny was saying that, because some few other guys, they wanted to do some things that kind of, which we were doing already. And it was like, bro, we at that level now where if it's not legacy attached to it, if it ain't something that's just going, when people just say, wow, And when Johnny started working with, he was designing the actual skyscraper that we're doing.
Unbelievable.
Bro, he designed it and instantly I knew. I was like, nah, this is legacy. This is a legacy.
How do you get to that conversation? How do you get to skyscraper conversation?
First off, I start with this one. Before you even talk about anything.
I tried to have a skyscraper conversation with Eve 10 years ago. He didn't want to listen.
Nah, bro.
You know what I'm saying?
I'm like
Eve,
want
to build a skyscraper.
Neither one of us can't do it, so yeah.
You could do it.
We only got an elevator,
that
bro.
That skyscraper. I will tell you this.
Start with the basics.
Yeah.
Now, Johnny going to give you the real practical stuff, but for me, the skyscraper starts in your head first.
Yeah.
It's got to be something that you believe, dog, because you can't name somebody that has done in our world. His world, he can probably name about 100 people right now.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But for us, and it's just like we walk past these skyscrapers every day. We go inside of them every day.
So is that what it was? Like you saw the side? Like, that's what I'm asking. Like,
where
what made you even
originate?
Know to say, I'm going to build a skyscraper? Like, I wouldn't even, like, that's not even something, a dream, like an impossible dream. Like, that's not even a dream I would have. Like, what made you even know skyscrapers existed?
I knew that was the next level for me.
Mm.
I've done everything. My house, I even developed my house. That's 21,000 square feet.
Got it.
Where else do you
Five
go?
Five levels.
Five levels. I might put a sixth one on since y'all talk. But where else do you go after that?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? My only problem was I didn't have the knowledge. I didn't have the exposure of it.
Yeah.
I knew that was the next level,
yeah.
But that's not just something where you just wake up one day and say, I can do it. You might say, yeah, I want one.
Yeah.
But it's so many moving parts to it that you need to know when it comes to development with it. And it's just like anything else. You can't do it on your own.
Yeah, no question.
When you're talking about something to that level, I've renovated properties. I did the 20,000 square feet. I ain't gonna say I'm on with my wife, but skyscraper. We're talking about now in upwards of $30, $40 million development.
Yeah, no
We're talking
question.
About so many moving parts,
yeah.
So many hundreds of people on this. You got so many moving parts. I just didn't know how it all came together until Johnny exposed us to it, and because he's done so many of them on his own.
You know, I'm just saying, for me as a African-American entrepreneur, just to be in a room with somebody saying they're going to do a skyscraper, it's just like, yo, God, I've grown. Like, I'm in the room with bros talking about a skyscraper. Mm-hmm. You feel what I'm saying? Like, I want people who are watching and listening to the podcast to understand that. Like, E.T., based on what I'm doing and contributing in the earth, I'm like, wow.
Yeah.
Like, I'm blown away. Like, yo, I'm sitting with some dudes that one person dreamed it, so I'm already knowing the way my brain worked. Once he started dreaming it, he about to start attracting everything it takes to do it. You know, so just much respect, but... just to be in the, I grew up sports, girls, fighting, gossip. You know what I'm saying? People pulling each other down. When you see other people doing something, that crab in the bucket.
Yep.
So to be in a room with a group of men talking about skyscraper and talking about supporting each other to build it, every time I see the pic with y'all in y'all suit on the land, I just be like, yo, I know them dudes.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, personally, like, I can pick up the phone and call them dudes. It's unbelievable.
Yeah, so Johnny, why don't you give us the background, man? Let us know. You know what I'm saying?
Some of them words.
Hey, both the backgrounds, too. The PhD one and the one you came into more crib with.
I might have to translate some of it to y'all.
Yeah,
I'm a little tough. Sometimes you get so deep with it, but.
I just want to get my mind blown. Yeah. Talk to me.
Hey, man, it's a blessing to be here, first of all, right? So this is all new to me.
Giving all honor to God. Come from Ebenezer Baptist.
Yeah, there you go.
Reverend Murray.
The Reverend Murray.
To the deacon boy.
Yeah,
come on, Johnny, get your prelims.
Everyone is used.
I'm going to sing a little solo.
My God.
But no, man, just humble beginnings, right? So that word humble goes a long way, you know, coming from... Everybody got a story about rough beginnings, but mine started with, if I fast forward it, not having a bed to sleep in. And my mom was like, hey, in order for you to get a bed, you got to choose one of these vocational schools, right? CVS, Simeon, because they are vocational schools and they'll teach you how to make a bed. Mm-hmm. So I chose CVS, Chicago Vocational High School. Went in there, my whole focus was just to make a bed.
So you didn't have a bed going into high school?
Right, I didn't have a bed. Sleeping on the floor, grabbing mattresses out the alley.
Elementary, middle,
yeah,
floor.
Yeah, we got to share. Like if somebody go to work or something, I get to, you know, you can sleep. And yeah, when they get off, you got to get out. You know, yeah, yeah, you sleep yeah on the porch, you outside all night. So successfully completed the bid, right? Won second place in the Museum of Science and Industry. Lost to somebody who built a boat at Lane Tech. But I was happy, and the whole Inglewood community was just like happy when I brought this bid home. It was like, Johnny got his bid, man. You know what I'm saying? Oh, Cherrywood. Wow. Yeah. So it was awesome. And that was my only focus, you know. So
I love story and entrepreneurship and how it all evolves. So forgive me if I'm cutting you off, but did you already have a architect spirit at that point, or you was just like, look, I need a bed, I'm about to figure this out? Or were you always like putting together Lego sets in like 30 seconds?
No, your ladder had no idea about drawing, building the bed or nothing. My thing was just like anybody coming from the South Mississippi to Chicago, migration, it's a hustle. It's just make money. If you're in the meat market or whatever, the whole goal is to make money and try to buy it, right? But I didn't have the opportunity, so that's how I got the bed. Right. So I made it. It was great. My teacher was awesome. And going to a vocational school, you don't know any. They don't really plug going to college.
Right.
Because you're supposed to go to work
after high school.
So leaving high school, trying to find a job, couldn't find that, turn right back to the streets.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Me and my best friend speed this story because I just told this at a high school last week.
It's our first time hearing it, so speed it up. Yeah, give us the whole thing.
So
I'm about to go back because I want to go back to Mississippi, but keep going.
Oh, absolutely. So we in Chicago doing nothing. I think Jamal was the police in my neighborhood.
He definitely was.
That was me.
Yin and Yangs.
So you the one that shot at Maul?
I know, right?
He ain't older than me now.
Wow. It's all coming together.
Hey, wouldn't that be something if that was him?
Oh, man.
And everybody out here would think I would beat you up, but you know what I would do? I told you, that 16-year-old kid that shot at me actually saved my life.
Did he?
Oh, he saved my life.
You weren't standing in front of Leo High School, were you?
No, I was on that. You much older than me, sir.
Right after the bed making competition. Go ahead.
But yeah, man, so we got into a lot of trouble. We had a lot of money, street guys. And he said, man, let's just run down to SIU because I got two girls that go to SIU. You know, they just graduated too.
Okay.
So we got down there the first 2 weeks. things got kind of rough. The girls were like, hey, y'all got to get out of here. 2 weeks, that's enough.
Are you down there staying there with them?
Yeah, Johnny be rushing through. Yeah. He's like, we went to see the girl. You know, 2 weeks go by. I'm like, wait. So y'all went and stayed with them?
We was high and we were running from the police, actually.
Gotcha.
Oh, okay, yeah.
And we had a lot of money, though.
Not a great detective.
So y'all were going with the money. Y'all ran with the money.
We ran with the money.
Okay.
All right, so we were good. We could have bought a house down anything, but I didn't know what that life was like. So one day, one of the girls just said, hey, y'all wasting y'all time. Why don't y'all come over to the university and register? I'm like, what is that? And what is a university? And what is registering? Mm-hmm. And she was like, oh, you come over here and, you know, you figure out what you're going to do with the rest of your life and all. And I'm like, man, I don't know what I'm going to do with my life, right? So my guy, being the guy he is, he said, well, what I do, I'm a major in criminal justice. I want to understand the law behind what I'm doing, right? So I was like, well, she said, well, Johnny, didn't you build a bed? I was like, yeah, I built the bed. She was like, well, why don't you go into engineering or architecture?
So you was well known throughout the state for this bed, man.
Oh, yeah.
She's like, you the cat that made the bed in Inglewood.
Absolutely.
Had a little status behind that bed.
You the bed, man.
I'm the bed, man. That's right.
Did you make any other beds?
That's the only one, man.
Okay.
The only one. Custom, everything.
Okay, so she like, you the one that made the bed. Don't let me throw you. Johnny, I tell a lot of jokes.
Yeah.
Don't let me throw you off.
I got one question. Was it a water bed?
Nah, but it was a platform.
Ooh, I had a water bed.
It was a platform bed that could have been a platform water bed.
Okay.
Yeah, cherry wood, yep. Absolutely.
Okay, so, yeah.
So she was like, just come over with me. We're going to figure out what your major's going to be, right?
So we you 18, 19?
Yeah, about 18, yeah. And, we get over there, she was like, architecture, right? So I was like, all right, cool. I have no idea what that word is, what it does or anything. And we met with some advisors and I was like, so y'all gonna teach me how to draw? And they was like, yeah, you're gonna do a lot of fine arts to where you gonna know how to draw by the time you get to, you know, the real major or whatever. So I was like, cool, put me in there. So we go to the dorms, and it was like maybe 15 beds in this one room. I was like, oh, we can't do this. I'm out of here. So we went and got a house. And 2 weeks after we registered, got in class, my best friend ended up doing 10 years.
Mm.
Yeah.
Mm.
Right, because at the time, it was a sitcom called 21 Jump Street.
Mm-hmm.
And we looked at the campus like 21 Jump Street. Like, oh, this wide open. This wide open. I was like, I don't think it's that wide open, bro. Mm. And I was like, I'm going to focus on this architecture stuff. Mm-hmm. Have fun with that.
Did you ever do anything with him on the college? Like,
no. Nah, when I got down there, nah, I was focused. I was like, I'm running from something already. So
was he still doing it? That's how he got caught up? Or?
Yeah, he was still doing it.
Oh, he was okay. So they didn't catch him for the old stuff.
That sounded like
nah, the new stuff.
Oh, okay, gotcha.
Yeah,
gotcha.
Yeah.
So they didn't get you for the old stuff either.
Nah.
All right, we got him, guys. Come in.
I was drunk.
Hey, you gotta go get Jay-Z too, man.
Yeah. I see y'all in the same cop car now.
Hey, good job. Yeah, look. I'm over here like working.
Justin, bad cop. Good cop over here.
So you
said you never got caught for that.
You put that light a little bit closer to that. Interrogation.
You say you bought the beer at 11. You know you done messed up, right?
You know you messed up, right?
All right. Come on, man. See these clowns, man. Come on,
Welcome to the
podcast. Anyway, you know, you going down there to see him. Looking at the situation, that's even more of a testimonial to me saying, yeah, I'm done with that, mm-hmm. right? So the other thing is that I'm in a program with nothing but white kids, right? White males.
Mm-hmm.
And the professors are constantly trying to get me to drop out. Like, oh, you need to go to auto mechanic or something. Oh, you need to go to black history or something. Like, no, I kind of like this, man. You know, I'm gonna keep drawing. So ended up, you know, getting the job, and believe it or not, the job was
graduating. In school.
Because,
oh, okay, gotcha.
You know, like people go to school and they don't know how hard it is as a student that you really ain't making money. You're spending money, and you don't have time to really work because you're doing 14 hours of classes. Yeah. So that's kind of rough.
Yeah.
So I ended up getting a job just to stay solid or whatever, and the job was basically picking up inmates and taking them to Minaj prison, like. Crazy. So I'm going to the prisons every day back and forth. I was driving the bus.
Oh, wow.
So that was another eye opener. Like, oh, okay, I see what you're doing. Yeah, let's talk.
Hopefully, you paid tuition.
Because I started working.
That's
look,
one.
Look, look,
that's one. I never had a bill. I never
had
a bill.
How long you been in with Maul, man?
I never had a bill at school.
Okay. Right. Okay. So no student loans.
No student
loans.
Had to work. Nothing. Yeah.
That's dope.
Yeah. So that was one. So, you know, you speed that up, you graduate, right? Now it's like, okay, you go get a job. I got an architecture degree. Can't find a job nowhere in Chicago. Right. Now, what do? My roommate at the time was another roommate that I met at SIU. He's in computer science. So he had a job going around fixing computers for big companies. So I still had enough money left over. So I said, man, I'm going to go buy me a computer. Right. Michael Dell. And I remember UPS saying, oh, man, we can't bring that computer to your neighborhood. You got to meet us on the expressway.
Mm.
Oh, I was like, whoa, bro, what's up, man? Like, come on, man, you can come to Inglewood. So I asked my roommate at the time to go get the computer with me. We got the computer. He's like, bro, how you buying a whole computer? Like, I'm the computer man. I was like, bro, the architects don't seem to be working. You seem to be making money. I figure if I buy this computer and tear this boy apart and read this thick book and put it back together and it work, then I'm going to go apply for a job at your company.
Wow.
And he was just like, what?
Yeah, that's a different brain right there. Yeah.
Yeah, okay. So I bought a brand new computer, rip it all the way apart, motherboards, RAM, everything, read this book, put the whole computer back together. And once it came on, he was just like, bruh. I was like, your job hiring?
Yeah. So, what's your qualifications?
Wow. I know everything about this computer, man. Yep. Everything, right. But what ended up happening was technology started getting so ahead of architecture
that I started just taking computers to the architectural firms.
Yeah.
And saying, hey, y'all can stop drawing by hand. I can show y'all how to do it from the computer perspective and print out your drawings. Because we were still drawing by hand back then. Like Mylar and, you know, vellum and stuff like that. So it'd be like 50 people in the architectural firm, everybody drawing something, a detail or something, like big room full of, but now there's computers getting ready to replace 50 people and cut them down to like 10. And then it's going to cut down even more. Next thing you know, it's like two people with computers doing the work of 50 people. So I figured I'd get ahead of that, and that's what I started doing. But I started with all the black architecture firms first. Every black architecture firm went in the yellow pages, went to the firm, hey, man, let me show you how to work this computer. You know, and they were just like, nah, man, we cool. Slamming the door in my face. And then this one, I'll never forget him, Mr. Smith. He was just like, I'm going to give you a shot. I was like, all right, let me show you. And he was a Reverend Smith, but he was an architect too. And I set it up, got it going. He was like, wow, man, this works, right? And then they paid me my little money on the contract side. I was gone. I got a phone call about 3 days later, like, hey, we forgot everything you taught us. We need you to come in here and do it with us until we learn how to do
that's
it.
Good. Mm-hmm.
So I didn't know anything about contracts, but I was like, okay, that's now I'm on a service contract. Like, let me figure out an hourly rate, how much my time is worth. I'm going to be here for this many hours. So now I'm in there teaching everybody. I'm in there for like a month, 2 months, you know. And then he started telling the other architects, man, y'all got to check out this boy, Johnny. He got this computer, man. The printer is doing the work of like 50 people. Next thing you know, another black architecture firm, the next one. So I knew like all the black architecture firms.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, they all came back. Absolutely. So that's then, so then like I'm like the tech person in the world of architecture, and the African-American, the black people are ahead of the white people in architecture.
Because
they got the technology first from me.
Yep.
Right. Because after them, I started going to them and they're just like, nah, we good. We can't get rid of all of these 50 people.
Yeah, you know?
But ain't nobody in there black though, right? So they want to take care of their people.
Yep.
So it's a message behind that. But to make a long story short, you know, eventually they opened up the doors too. And it's like, wow. So there's a $1 trillion company called Autodesk. I don't know if anybody know what that is, but Autodesk is behind probably every engineering architecture building in the world, but they also the company that does the software to make the movies, like any type you see, like Superman tearing down the building, Godzilla, they got all that software too, like Maya, 3D Studio Max, you know, so they make all this software. So they need teachers to teach the software.
Mm-hmm.
So there were two guys in Chicago. I ain't gonna say his name, but one guy
who say his name.
Paul Albin. All
right. Paul shout Albin out writes to Paul.
Shout out to Paul. Paul writes the books for Autodesk. He's an expert, but he's only a theorist. He can tell you what it's supposed to do.
Mm.
But he had to come and get me to say, this dude know how to make it happen.
Yep.
So me and him linked up together and started going to all of the big architectural firms like SOM and all of these people. And he'll be like, here's the theory. Johnny can show y'all how to do it, right? So we was making a lot of money doing that and writing the books for Autodesk and teaching classes. And I started teaching at the universities and stuff like that. So he was getting me into all the universities teaching. It was just the doors just started opening up.
It's crazy.
So that's the educational and the first work. But if you rewind it back, the first job that I ever got was with a structural engineering company. And I was happy. And even my roommate with the computer, he was like, man, you finally got one. I was like, man, it's a structural engineering company. And he was like, how much they paying you? I was like, man, they said $5 an hour. Mm. He was like, $5 an hour? I was like, yeah. But I need to go there because I need to learn. It's still school for me.
Right, absolutely.
I'm getting paid to go to school now, right?
What year was this?
This was probably 1996, 1997. So when I get there, they do the woo-wop on me, right? It's like, oh, you the chauffeur. Your job is to take us down to Congress and the state and sleep in the limo while we sleep in the hotels overnight and we lobby for bridge contracts, you know, roads, structural tall buildings and stuff. You know, you drive us down there, you sleep in the car, we there for 3 days, we'll let you in the room when we out to take a shower. And I was just like, whoa, bro, like I ain't signed up for this, you know? So in there, I started kind of like trying to holler at some of the engineers, like, hey man, just teach me a little something, man. Let me use this. I know how to do the computer stuff, bro, you know, blah, blah, blah. And one dude was like, very spiritual guy, was like, hey man, come by my house at night and I'm gonna show you how we doing these bridges and roads and stuff like this.
Come on.
And I was at his house like praise every God. Night, man, every
praise
night.
God.
You know what I'm saying? He was teaching me everything.
It was a bruh.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And he was just like, I got you. Very religious. This guy was very, very, very religious. Like, come in the house, pray, eat dinner with him. Just changed my whole understanding of spirituality, bruh. Too.
Mm-hmm.
And was teaching me enough to where eventually I was like, okay, I got this. Same company, $5 an hour, Reverend Granberry. 13th of Michigan, True Rock Ministry. He walks in and he says, hey, it's a black guy in this structural engineering company. And he came over and he said, hey, how much they paying you? I said, man, they paying me like $5 an hour. He said, man, they got these people named as the people who's designing my building. Is your name Johnny Mullins? I was like, yeah. He said, I said, right here, you getting paid. I'm being billed for your time at $75 an hour. I was like, whoa, I don't see none of that. I see the five.
Yeah.
Not the 70.
That's wow. Crazy, bro.
Yeah. So he said, you and the Hispanic guy are the only ones at the site digging in the ground, trying to figure out the foundation, structural components of the building. I was like, yeah, I don't know how much he getting, but I know I'm getting that five and I'm stretching it. He was like, I tell you what.
Got the grind is five. That five is crazy. That five is crazy.
The five is crazy.
You was getting more than the five piece in the joint.
Oh, wow.
You know what I'm saying? Oh, I was like, hold on. Of course, I was in the joint getting more than that.
Man. So anyway, Reverend Granberry says, you know what, man? I'm sick of this. How about you lead this company right now, and I give you the $75 an hour?
Wow.
And you design that building yourself.
I'm talking about good night.
Can you do it? I was like, man, if I go home, my mom going to shoot me so many times. He was like, I have a conversation with your mom.
That's good.
Then I was like, well, what about the equipment? I need this. He said, I'll give you the money to start up the ball equipment. Then I was like, bro, I don't think I know how to do this by myself.
Yeah.
He was like, God going to help you do it.
Mm. Wow.
I was like, let's roll. I designed and built that whole entire church, man.
$75
by hand, drawing with a pencil, paper.
An hour though.
That's what I'm saying.
$75 an hour.
Yeah, you said 75 total.
You know, I'm just saying. You know, I'm just saying. Meaning, he cut out the other people.
Yeah, went to you for
$75 an hour.
Yeah,
that's crazy.
Yeah.
But you benefited.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah, I want to go back to what you said in the beginning, man. I just wanted to run through a wall, bro. Like, man, you know, just working with. I want to say young people, but just people in general.
Mm-hmm.
It's like people don't understand, bro. It's no shortcuts, bro.
Oh,
you know? Like, I wish it was, even for my own. Like, yo, bro, I'm telling you the truth, bro. Like, people going to find out. Like, I wish I could just give it to my son.
Oh, yeah.
I wish I could just give it to my daughter. I do. We just got off a call. We do a training with Chase Bank. And they're trying to, you know, put my kids in a position to, what's the word? You know, like we talk about legacy living, but actually
to be good
be
stewards
equipped
of generational
for legacy
wealth.
Living.
Yeah,
like not just the terminology.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying? And so in the end of one of our discussions, man, changed everything, bro. She was like, all right. So Jalen's gonna be the CEO, and Jaden's gonna be the COO.
Oh wow!
So she's like just the months we spent together, I see like where they naturally fall. Jaden's more organized, so she's gonna take care of all the operations. Jalen is more creative, you know, CEO, and then you're gonna shift to chairman. And I'm sitting there going like, whoa, I see why we have to do this and why I had to give them that position so that now I can give them the real roles and responsibilities that come with it.
Yeah.
And then just be like, look, this ain't no joke. So Bull got three products, a book he wrote. So I'm just like, Jay, I ain't trying to be funny, but, you know, much respect to LeBron, you know, and Bronny, Dion, you know, and his kid. I was like, son, it's a roadmap.
Absolutely.
You know what I'm saying? I said, unfortunately for us, the roadmap is education.
Absolutely.
So you wrote the book, but now you're gonna have to really get your vocab straight because you're going to be going into schools because that's where our money is. Universities, whatever. You did a book on freshmen, high school, freshman, college. That's all school. So it was crazy because my dude, Dr. A, he was like, let me get Jay's book, you know, and read it. And I already knew the deal because John Maxwell's people helped him, you know, with the books. I already knew it was going, like, you know what I'm saying? When you say who in the class, like, I know it wasn't written from this perspective. I know it's written from that perspective. Oh, yeah. So then I already knew it was going. But my man said something deep. He said to Jalen, I'm going to read it, and I'm going to show you how to activate it in every school in this country.
Wow.
He said, but number two, did you do an audio book? You need an audio book because now I got two products I can sell.
Mm.
And then can you lecture? Because if you can lecture, I got three products I can sell.
Mm.
You feel me? And I'm like telling my son, like, bro, all this time you worried about what other people think. You sitting here telling me you don't speak.
Ooh.
But now here go your shot to make bread. So now you're going to have to go back and work on your vocabulary and practice speaking because my man is telling you that's where your bread is coming from.
Mm. Mm.
You feel me? So when I hear you talk about stripping this thing and putting it back, man, I wish as a father, all the stripping I did, I could just be like,
mm-hmm.
Here you go.
Yeah.
But, put together. Bro, the reality is, if you don't strip that joker, if you don't go do your $5 an hour, boy, you feel me?
Absolutely.
If you don't go do that, if you don't, you know, if you don't go to another environment outside, like, bro, it's just not going to work.
Right.
You know, and so, man, when we was talking in a different podcast, I was like, yo, I'm that dude, bro. Like, I'm really that dude that my wife said it. She said she was on a call. You heard her on a call talking to this individual. She's like, yo, my husband, like, you got it twisted. You shouldn't have called me. He should have told you no from the beginning.
Yeah.
I would have shut you down. But he cares about people's feelings. And what he was trying to do was help you. But now you're throwing dirt on my man's name. Mm. He should have told you no in the first place. Like, nobody should ever had a right to use his likeness or image. But because you are economically struggling, he gave you that shot. But now you coming back pissed because he didn't tell you yes. He didn't say yes to you. And for me, it was just like, you know, Didi ain't mean, but Didi is more like, yo, this is just what it is. I don't care if you're my child or not. Like, I can't give you anything. Now, I can give it to you, but according to Anthony Flynn, by that third generation, they done blew everything. They done blew everything. So that's why we at Chase, and my thing is with the next generation, they're going to have to go through something and learn and go through because it's like, yo, if you give it to them, whatever. So just hearing you speak, man, it just, I got goosebumps like hearing Michael Jackson sing Smokey Robinson's song. And Smokey was like, look, that was my song, period. But when Mike sang it, it was no longer my song.
Right.
He was like, Mike took it. So when people sing it today,
I wonder.
And he was.
Which song
is that? Yeah, that's it, right?
That's it, yeah.
Okay.
Loving.
Who's loving you?
Yep.
Oh, yeah.
And he said, Mike, he was like, Mike was five.
He said he was singing that song before Mike was born.
Before Mike was born, that I was singing it. But Mike ripped it. Why? All them hours of studying and practicing. And Mike is still one of the individuals that I listen to regularly and I get chills.
Because,
like, you could really see he took his craft serious.
Absolutely.
That he surpassed, now I shouldn't use the word surpassed because it's going to be some, like, you know, music critics. It's like, you can't say that. But a Jackie Wilson, a James Brown, like, people that he looked up to, he came in and murdered it. You feel me? And so when I hear you tell your story, I get chills because if people would do what you said, strip it down and bring it back up, As difficult as stripping it sounds, once you strip it and put it back up, you rich for the rest of your life, bro.
If you've ever bought any grind gear from us or earlier books, you have been on Shopify. And listen, guys, today I want to put you on the other side of the Shopify cash register. Shopify is the global commerce platform that helps you sell at every stage of your business. And that's why we've rocked with them for so long. They grew with us from the launch of your online shop stage to the first real life store stage, all the way to the, did we just hit $1 million stage? Shopify is there to help you grow. Whether you're selling scented soap or offering outdoor outfits, Shopify helps you sell everywhere from their all-in-one e-commerce platform to their in-person POS system. Wherever and whatever you're selling, Shopify's got you covered. Shopify helps you turn browsers into buyers with the internet's best converting checkout. 36% better on average compared to other leading commerce platforms. And sell more with less effort thanks to Shopify Magic, your AI-powered all-star. Hey, one of the dope things that Shopify has done recently is that you don't even have to sell just your own stuff anymore. Shopify Collective, it's a newer initiative. You can actually curate products to sell from other brands that you love, giving your customers even more variety and your business more visibility and more sales. Shopify powers 10% of all e-commerce in the United States, and Shopify is the global force behind brands like Allbirds, Rothy's, and Brooklinen, and millions of other entrepreneurs of every size across 175 countries. Plus, Shopify's award-winning help is there to support your success every step of the way. Because businesses that grow, grow with Shopify. Sign up for a $1 per month trial.
Man.
You rich for the rest of your life.
Absolutely.
You never have to. Man, one of the greatest feelings for me, and the way people making money now, bruh, I just laugh because I'm like, yo, I've been around long enough on the internet to know that everybody who started on the internet ain't on it now.
Right.
Yeah, and everybody that was making money ain't making money now.
Yep.
I remember Spreewell was like 10 mil. What I'm going to do with that? And I remember him not being on no team again and getting the 10. So I'm sure at some point he probably would have eat the 10 million up to this day. And so I've just seen people who made money come and go because they forget the most important part, especially for those of us who come from, you know, being enslaved. For me, bro, manhood is the goal for me.
Yeah.
Like, I ain't tripping on no money. I'll take 200 grand if I can live life on my own terms.
Yep.
We done had all kind of opportunities. I'm like, bro, if they got to own me, I'm good.
Yes, sir.
I don't need to make 100 mil if you own my time.
Right.
I'm still enslaved.
That's right.
If you own my, I can't say this, I can't say that, I got to get up. Bruh, I'm good. Like, I'm good on the money. I just want to be a man.
Absolutely.
Period. I just want my wife to see me as a man. I want my son and daughter to see me as a man.
Absolutely.
And maybe, you know, in the little crew we got, you know, whatever extent they go, all right, he a man in his word. But outside of that, bruh, I'm solid. So when I heard you say you stripped it, you brought that, I'm just like, wow. That's big, bruh.
Oh, big. Man. Blessings, blessings.
And so how do we get to where we are from there? What's the transition?
Yeah, about 50 churches later.
Wow. Yeah, so you started just doing mostly churches.
Yeah, churches, because he kept introducing me to another minister, another church.
Mm-hmm.
So I did, man, I got my feet wet and turned into gold and everything in churches first.
Really?
Yeah.
And you were doing it independently, or were you doing it with him?
Independently.
Oh, really? Just all independent?
I never had a job after that until...
Unbelievable.
8 years ago.
Really?
When I wanted to go to this company because I knew how big they were, and I was switching from architecture to construction.
Okay.
So I wanted to start building high rises. I was like, oh man, this company, I got to get in here. And they didn't let me in the first, second, third time. Mm-hmm. I ended up sending one of my guys who they needed, an electrical engineer. I was like, hey, man, you get in there. And then you figure out if they got any VDC engineers. And if they don't,
get me in.
He was like, they just hired one. I was like, he ain't cold as me.
Yeah.
He ain't cold as me. Let me see what he's doing. And he ended up hiring me. Mm. And I ended up replacing them.
Oh, wow.
They ended up letting them go and kept me.
Man.
Yeah.
What's his name?
Paul.
Another Paul.
Paul Wright.
Real quick, man, because when Mar gets back, I want y'all to talk about the exchange and what y'all got going on, because it's obviously just, you know, phenomenal and exciting.
This
he
big,
talked about, yeah, you know, how crazy it was.
Big, bro.
Real quick, talk about Mississippi. And Johnny, he looked like he in his 30s. He's a little older than you think. So when you hear it, you know what I'm saying? You
go, we went to school together.
Yeah, yeah, right. But man, but talk about what was that like? Because I heard Johnny said we was talking about, man, yeah, he grew up and it was kind of like poor. And Johnny was like, nah, I don't think y'all know poor. He was like, bro, where I lived in Mississippi, it was a different. What was that like?
Oof. Man, let me tell you something. It's hard for me to go back to Mississippi.
Yeah.
I get invited back over and over and over again. I'd be like, bro, I can't do it. It takes a lot for me to drive.
Just
down
like the memories of what?
The memories, man. Emmett Till, bro, that was a real thing.
Uh-huh.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Like the manners, the rules, the regulations,
the same,
not
bro.
Being able to look, not being able to say, you ain't got no shoes on, you know. That's a real thing in the South, man. You know, that network that says Back to the South or something, the guy who just, I just saw that and I was like, he was like, oh, it's easy. We could have just took over Mississippi. I was like, bro, you crazy.
Yeah. Yeah.
There's a reason why that ain't Atlanta.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
No
like,
question.
It was totally different in the Delta. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's why we had a Civil War. But I grew up, man, it was crazy, bro. Like, I don't know what you call this, a house, a barn or something with like maybe 20 people, 30 people in there. You could see straight through the floor, you know, to the dirt. You're taking baths and like the thing that Mandinka got killed in.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? That's how we take our baths. You know what I'm saying? You heat the water outside, you know, and get in this big old tub and go to work and get back out of it and all this stuff. And everybody growing their own food. I mean, fishing, you know, it was free food. I mean, if you didn't have anything to compare it to, that's a good life.
Mm-hmm.
But once you started comparing it, like I had cousins in Chicago, I'm like, whoa, man, they living like this?
Yeah.
And I'm living, but if I would have never saw that, I'd have been like, this is what it is.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? But I was, the story I tell everybody is like, a bus used to come in front of our house and be lines of people like you know, the Home Depot people, when, you know what I'm saying? But all black people. And a guy would get off and he'd just pick people. And you get on this bus and you gone from like 4 a.m. till about 6 p.m. And they would come back with money. And they would go to the stores and they could buy all type of stuff. I'm like, wow, man, when is it my turn? And my aunt was like, boy, they going to chop cotton. You next, you got one more year. You got one more year and you can get on that bus and go chop cotton. And I'm like, man, I can't wait. Mm. Woo, I'm gonna be able to buy a whole loaf of bread, some lunch meat, some pig feet, pickles, bread, Coca-Cola, all that type of stuff. And my dad, he wanted, I was playing, my dad was basketball. He had me getting ready to, like, I got you, you're gonna go to Mississippi State, you know, all of his players, he a coach and Mississippi Valley State and all that type of stuff. But my mom was in Chicago, and finally I was just like, bro, I ain't got no money. I see what my other cousins and stuff are doing in Chicago. Can you just come get me, man? Like, I'm the only one left down here. Y'all done came, got everybody but me. Like, y'all got everybody but me. And she finally was like, all right, it ain't as easy as you think it is in Chicago, but you want to come? Come on. And then I was like, oh, this is... this is different.
Yeah.
It's a little better if that's what you want to say it is, but I'm still sleeping on floors and in the alleys and got to hustle. And
that's real,
it's the same thing. I was like, bro, it's just how you look at it. It's your perspective. But to know that my cousins, you know, my mom had 11 siblings, all of the kids, everybody in one house. And man, they used to just seem like they had the cars, the clothes, everything. My mom was like, boy, please. I remember the first pair of Jordans, I bought a white pair of Air Force Ones and took a red and black Sharpie and went to work.
That's true where you learned to draw.
True architect.
And went to school and was like, he got the new Jordans. I was like, got the new Jordans.
Yeah.
Right? You know what I'm saying? But that's the only way I could get it.
Nobody busted you out?
Nah, nobody. No. Well, I was a little different too. So I don't think nobody would have tried it.
Oh, okay, got you. Yeah, look. I'll show you what a Mississippi app would look like.
Absolutely. Yep.
Okay, so real quick, man, because I want to make sure we leave time for y'all to discuss the exchange and kind of how y'all became, you know, to do this project that is monumental in the city of Chicago, that is, you know, historical, you know, quite frankly. Mal, I'll let you kind of talk about it and, you know, how, you know, Johnny came to be on that team and y'all, you know, where y'all at now and, you know, what we can be expecting.
Yeah, well, we got on the team at the same time. And like I said, it was all about bringing that vision to light. We all talked about, so we could have built or developed a skyscraper anywhere, but we picked this community, right? This community, man, is a historically Black community. You had a lot of, back in the day, you had a lot of professionals, right? Doctors and the lawyers. You know, it was like families. And just over the years, that community has become desolate, man. You don't see, it's like ran down businesses, you know, boarded up properties. And there's no quote unquote skyscraper. I don't know, Johnny, any skyscrapers? No skyscrapers in that area, right?
No, it's nothing. I mean, you got high rise buildings.
You got high rise, but it's nothing that you would consider really like a nice skyscraper. So, we could have put this money in any community, but we decided to put it back in this community. Mm-hmm. And it's so crazy that, you know, we own multiple properties in that area.
Yeah.
But President Obama, he actually chose that area to put his presidential library in. Tiger Woods got a golf course that's right, like adjacent to where we actually at. And we're right across the street from the lakefront. And so the proximity of it is just great. And we just felt that, you know, we wanted it with kids, man. You know, when they walk past that building, bro, they just get inspired.
Absolutely.
Yeah. You know, it's we wanted something that was going to outlive us. And when people walk by, they're going to say, man, like somebody that looked like me actually owned this place. Yeah. Now, we've been approached. I don't even know if I told you. I think I did talk to you about it. We've been approached. Now that we got it up to this point, we've been approached by multiple people. One group in particular offered
$64
million. Offered $64 million to buy us out. They want CJ. Like, why you ain't taking?
No, nobody called me.
CJ, like, why you ain't taking?
I didn't get the call.
Yeah,
I didn't get the call in the 64.
Should have been gone.
But, listen now, listen.
As soon as I got my money, I was gone.
It's deeper than the money, though.
No question.
Because for one thing, you know, we own the land outright. Of course, we own the drawings on it. You know, the entitlements. They want to come in now and just take it. And this is supposed to be a summer.
The 64 now. You know,
wait a minute, take.
I said take. Now, take is what they did to us back in the day. 64 million.
But I'm just saying.
They made a fair
we
offer.
We did all the heavy lifting. Yeah. We did all the heavy lifting already in the front.
Yeah.
This building is.
Once it's a heavy check for the heavy
once lift. It's completed, what's the value of the building?
Once it's completed, it's going to start off at about 110.
That's completed.
And then 5-year waterfall, about 260.
So do you settle for 60 or do you go for the 260?
Well, in your case, you go for the 260.
I was always taught.
But somebody might.
Yeah.
I'm just saying.
Somebody might say, hey, we don't want to do no more work.
And it's about the civilization of it.
The legacy, the civilization.
Bro.
You know what I'm saying?
No question.
You see me, Justin? Yeah.
So one thing about Johnny, and I'll let him pick it up from here. Johnny, he majored, I think your doctorate degree is in community psychology.
Absolutely.
Community psychology.
Man, I don't know what it's in. But let me tell you this. We was in Florida.
Oh, that
was a good story.
Justin. No. I'm not throwing no gas here.
Right.
Y'all know, listen, I done been around the best in the world in a lot of different fields.
Yep.
This man right here is the greatest to ever do it. I don't care what nobody say. Mm-hmm. I have never in my life been more impressed with watching a man stand up in the room and deliver a presentation. It was massive.
Oh, I
when
heard
I say
about it on
masterful,
many occasions. He called me on many occasions.
Bro, it was like he turned into different person, bro. I was like,
hold on, man. Hold on. Before you go there. Before you go there, though, hold on. And when he said a master, just to give an example, there were other individuals in the room who was supposed to be talking at the time.
Right.
And we was losing bad. I'm going to just say that. We were losing, and then it was
we might have been down by 10.
Oh, we was down.
3 minutes left.
The game was over.
Yeah.
It was over.
Johnny it was shot Bears us versus back Lions into the game.
Last week, 2 weeks ago. It was over.
Bruh, this man, I'm dead serious. Now, mind you, again, I'm in the room quiet. Yep. First of all, I'm just monitoring. I'm basically just more sounding board to be like, hey, bruh, this is what I picked up on, yeah. Whatever. When I tell you, bruh, by the time he was finished, it changed the whole conversation. My man was like, okay, we done went from what I thought this was about to like, who are you and can you just...
Yep.
I never seen nothing
I need
like
to said.
No, no, no. I can't. Oh, I would do it an injustice to even try to say.
Yeah.
But I'm just saying, and I didn't even know half the stuff that he was talking about. It didn't make sense to me.
Yeah.
But I watched the faces of the individuals in here who do it at the absolute highest level.
Highest.
Yeah. And they were blown away.
Yeah. Yeah.
They never seen nothing like what he was not even just talking about, showing them on the. Wow. It was incredible, bro. It was literally one of the most incredible things I've seen. And I talk about it all the time. I like, bro, I ain't never seen nothing like that. So anyway, I just want to give people their flowers.
I appreciate especially that.
Especially as
man.
A bruh, too.
Blessing.
Because, you know, a lot of times you think, oh, the bruh, we hear about, oh, man, the bruh going to cut corners, man. Right. You can't go to the black man. He ain't going to be, you know, his stuff ain't going to be up to par and da-da-da-da. You hear those things, man. And to see it, not only a bruh just operating, you know.
Excellence.
A way above the board was phenomenal, bro.
So that's inspiring, bro.
I appreciate that.
Yeah, it's inspiring, bro. Straight up, it was inspiring.
It's inspiring, bro.
I called my wife like, I just witnessed something crazy.
Y'all don't know though when
think he called me right after he called his wife.
I did.
Bro, when the other individuals,
my work
wife. Hey, when the other individuals was talking, remember I hit you on the side? Yeah. I was hitting Johnny on the side.
He was tapping me.
I said, Johnny, get up. I said, go. I said, bro, this is our last resort, bro. This is it. We throwing everything in the kitchen sink. I was like, Johnny. Go ahead.
Yeah.
Johnny went up there, dog, killed it.
So what was this meeting about, though? What was
this? I let them.
Johnny.
But, yeah.
Well, maybe can't say.
Justin's the Fed.
Yeah.
Justin the Fed.
I'm trying to say.
Justin the Fed.
I've been taught well. I ain't saying.
Okay. It was just about a partnership in real estate.
Yeah. Got it. Okay.
Huge partnership.
Yeah. Okay.
Like,
but like I said, to see that level of excellence
at work
and to see how they were looking, because they. Yeah. Above us.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, like, for sure.
Bro, I'm talking about the office alone. Yeah. Where it was like, okay. It, shout out to them, though. You're bro, too.
Yeah.
I'm talking about.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
Oh, no.
High level.
The high level.
Yep.
High level.
Well,
I was looking
like 10th floor.
Bro, you know, like, when you got, imagine just having Shaq on your team. And Shaq just dunking on everybody. That's how I felt when Johnny. And because Johnny ain't say nothing the whole time.
Yeah.
Until it was his turn.
Yep.
I'm talking about.
Dang.
Hours, not a word. So I didn't know what to expect. I was just like, oh, okay, it's Johnny turn.
Yeah.
Bruh.
Clinic.
I don't know what, bruh.
Clinic. Bruh. Yeah.
He put up 60 in about 10 minutes. Bruh. I'm talking about, it was that level of excellence.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I just want to say to those who are listening, man, for real, I know we've been trained because of our poverty mindset. We've been trained to be the best in the room.
Yep.
You know, we actually are inferior when there are people in the room who are doper than us. Mm-hmm. You know, we are envious or jealous or we feel uncomfortable. You know, but I heard Mignon say something on our mastermind this morning. Mignon was like, yo, I want y'all to think of, you know, like your wildest dream. Like, what do you want? Like, give me your wildest dream. So I'm like, okay, you know, sound normal. Where are you going? I get it. And then she curveball maul. She said, okay, based on your wildest dream, who are you hanging with that is doing that?
That's good.
She's like, yo, who you?
Max.
She like, so all this stuff you just named, name one person in your five that's remotely close to it. And everybody was like, none. And she's like, then how are you ever going to get to it? How are you ever going to get to it?
That's great.
And so for me, you know, being in the room, you know, with giants, you know, it's a healthy drive, like a healthy, I don't want to use the word competition, but I feel like that's the only word that a lot of the people that are listening would resonate with.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but I mean competition.
We're going to break that. That's Motown.
Okay.
Motown. Yeah. Remember we talked about it. Yeah. I mean
that more though, like iron sharpening iron.
Of course. Absolutely. It's competition too. You want to, and you feel pressure to pull your own weight and to go to the next level?
Well, everybody don't feel pressure, but you should feel pressure.
The A players will.
Yeah.
But it's funny because, you know, when we talk about, you know, before when we were talking about finding a mentee, mentor, and relationships and all of that, and I say become a savage, you find a savage. Was it any doubt that Marl and Johnny was eventually going to meet?
Yeah, no.
It had to happen at some point.
Yeah.
They it was two masters, you know what I'm saying,
I think
working
even
on their craft.
People that was with us knew it too.
Oh, bro.
It was kind
of
like,
so I'm saying the world got a crazy way of, when you handle your business, take care of yourself, stop looking for somebody to save you, and master something on your own, you're going to run into other masters. It was no doubt at some point. Y'all both was in Chicago for a long time. You heard rumblings of name, maybe, but at some point, the world was just going to force y'all to come together, and now what it's creating and what y'all are doing now is just insane. And, you know, I'm whatever small part I'm playing in it, you know, I don't want to be in the cliff notes, you know what I'm saying?
The biggest part.
Little, you know, just a little something, a little light something.
Hey, Gordy.
But, you know, hey, man, listen, we'll get to that. But the exchange, man, anything else y'all want to say about the exchange before we are just –
Yeah, just real quick. So, like the young man said, you know, I don't know, man. Y'all be saying, don't say certain stuff. But just to give you a gist of it, I know my worth. I've designed for sheiks.
Yeah.
I've built
Tell him. Yeah, go talk your talk. We
talk heavy, Dubai,
buildings,
you know what I'm saying?
Right?
You talk heavy,
but come on.
Yeah, go ahead.
Talk dirty. So,
we embrace that. Here.
So,
see, I told you about Mississippi. Now let me say it. Say about New Johnny.
Bring it on.
I told you about broke Johnny.
Right.
Tell you about rich Johnny.
Yeah. So let me just say, people with a lot of money can push the envelope, right? They can ask for things that has not been done. So as engineers, it's our job to figure out how to get it done. So when you say black sand attracts, you know, solar heat from the sun, that's a beach that's unwalkable. And a sheik say to you, I want to be able to walk on my black sand beach. We say, we'll be right back. And then we put air conditioning under the entire beach, right? If a sheik says, we want a snowboard, but it never gets lower than 75 degrees over here, we say, we'll be right back. And we build you a whole mountain of snow inside with a cooling sensor that can keep that temperature. Now we got people snowboarding and skiing in Dubai. So when you have that exposure, right?
No, bro. I wish we had it on tape when I saw. Bro, I saw the manifestation of that, bro. Like when you say, oh, a 0.001 degree temperature change in 10 years from now could possibly lead to where this source is. I've never seen nothing like it. I'm just telling you.
Yeah.
It was a level of excellence. Plus, Johnny be building this stuff now where he could put you, let's say you wanted to build a crib. Bro, he designed the crib. Bro, he will build the entire house for you. You put on some virtual goggles and walk through your whole crib.
Absolutely.
No. The entire crib. Like, Johnny, can I get, I want another window right here. Oh, I'm walking into my master. Oh, how many lights I want? Can I get another can reset? Bro, it's just stupid stuff, bro. It's really.
I need that for the team.
It's ridiculous, bro. Like I said, I never seen nothing like it, and I've seen it now in, you know, multiple settings, and it's just incredible. Seriously, brother, to watch you come from where you came from and to be able to do it at this level, and you and Maul to be partnered up just now, and just the beginning, man. And man, can people it ain't really nothing they could do to join the cause or nothing, but you know, just sit back and watch and wait and support. But man, congratulations.
Oh man, I appreciate it. I love the coming. Like, Jamal is taking me to another level, which I'm a novice in this arena.
Yep.
Right? So like you said, my craft, I can speak on it. You know, I can know, like, we were showing them guys. I was like, oh, that's what y'all in here doing? Jamal like, get them, Jay. I'm let me show you how to get a better return on your investment.
Yeah.
Y'all in high-rise building, I work for the top people.
Yeah.
I've designed for the top people.
How many skyscrapers you think you built? Or like buildings all together?
Oh, man, definitely. I couldn't even count. Altogether, high rises, I'd probably say like about 300.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
And how many Chicago, like how many in Chicago?
Most in Chicago? Nah, but in Chicago, we probably got about maybe a good 35, 40. Mm-hmm. I got four new ones on the way.
Okay.
That we just started breaking ground on like about 4 weeks ago.
Mm-hmm.
And we build communities. So like I said, the Sheikh Al-Gahair is who loaned the money to the developers in Dubai. Mm-hmm. So I'm on the phone with him every night. He's like, I loaned the money to the developers to build Dubai. His name is Al-Gahair. So he wanted us to build a city for him. And we built a city for him. And it was funny, like one of the
Al Gahair number.
You gotta talk to him about a couple of
things. No, I got. I just need to let him. Give me my man number,
yeah,
real
yeah,
quick,
yeah.
so I can ask to pick his brain, mentor.
Brothers got money, man.
Yeah, Al Gahair.
My
now.
Yeah, let me ask you one last question.
Pick your brain real quick
before we get out of here.
Yep.
So, man. So. Of course.
And other big news you helping E with. You know what I'm saying?
Design. Oh, yeah.
He finally got a pool now.
Bro, that you know what I'm saying? That's an oasis.
Yeah. He didn't have a pool.
I didn't have a lot of stuff. Yeah. You talked about, you know, Mississippi. And Mississippi is one of those places that 50 years later, you go back to it, look the exact same.
Yeah.
Mm.
You know what I'm saying? So it looks like slavery.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? It's like you go in certain pockets. It's the exact same thing. I think they just... Maybe 5-6 years ago, the law was just passed where you could have interracial.
Blacks could vote.
Yeah. Like get married.
Yeah.
Like imagine that. Like
shout out to Jonathan and Kendra holding Mississippi down. You know what I'm saying?
We got a few people
follow from the SIP, man.
I only know of it because my people from Mississippi.
Yeah.
But my sister went to Piney Woods.
Okay, yeah.
Only thing we knew about Mississippi was "Am I crooked letter, crooked letter?"
All the time.
Oh, that was big.
That's the first one. That's all I knew
about Mississippi.
That's huge.
I don't think I ever been to Mississippi.
We still have family reunions.
I've never actually been to
West Point, Mississippi.
Oh yeah, I've been there a few times, bro.
Never.
But I can tell you, I can tell you this.
My family, matter of fact, my great 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 grandfather was one of the slaves. That was free that built Mount Bayou, Mississippi.
Oh, yeah, Mount Bayou, yeah.
Yeah, he got the wheel, right?
Yeah, I got a picture of the wheel.
That's where my people from Mount Bayou, yeah, Greenville, Greenwood, Florisdale. Yeah.
Man, look at this.
Everybody family really from there.
Mount Bayou.
We all from
Chicago, definitely.
It ain't but a few places.
Alabama.
My great grandma was born
Georgia, Louisiana, Mississippi.
Yeah.
Bama, it was just... Everybody
Something that just recently happened is Jose, one of y'all guys, I think he do the courses.
Mm-hmm.
He was telling me something about Wall Street Trapper or something like that, the guy, and that Rick Ross was on his show or something like that. And I was like, man, my mom used to babysit Rick Ross.
Wow.
My mom and Rick Ross' mom were best friends coming up in Mississippi.
Mm.
And I was like, man... I'm just, you know, Chicago, we cut different. It's like, I ain't finna be like, But now I'm different. Like, hey, man, let me holler at you for a minute. You know, if I was to see him. So he put me on the phone with one of Rick Ross' guys, and my auntie was texting me at the same time. Ross just left it. They just sent balloons up for his grandmother. They stay at Magnolia Court. I was like, oh, man, that's crazy. So, but my thinking was I'm into building Black Wall Streets now. I'm into developing communities, brand new communities from ground up, businesses, restaurants, bars, you name it. So I was like, if I could get Rick, we could change Mississippi. We could change that part of Mississippi. Yeah. We can go down there and redo that whole thing and turn it into a Black Wall Street. Hmm. But that was just a little.
Yeah. But I was going to ask you, because there's so many people who will say, because of those beginnings, they can't get to this end.
Yeah.
You feel me? Because like you said, it's tough, bro. It's like it's not growing up in a normal environment.
Absolutely.
Give me one or two things that you think you had to do mentally to like let that Mississippi mindset go. Even Chicago mindset, to be real, because Chicago is about hustling.
Absolutely.
And gangs. So what did you do to, you know, change that mentality?
The minister, Louis Farrakhan, they interviewed me to say, man, how did you do this stuff when I was about 20? I think I had my first $3 million when I was 24, 25. It's an interesting story that we can come back to that on another one, but how I got that first $3.5 million at a young age was God sent, right? But growing up the way we grew up, I picked up traditional Kung Fu, right? So people would think you go to Kung Fu just to learn how to fight and beat up people. But really, you're going to get beat up so many times by your Sifu or your master to where you don't want to really hurt nobody, right? So you understand how to render somebody harmless with words first and saying peace and I'm walking away and blah. So it's a whole mental stress relieving meditation thing that you become one with yourself, right? Mind, body, and spirit. And that is what I contribute to being able to let go of the nuances of growing up poor and stuff like that. That's my foundation. It's like getting on your knees and praying five times a day or pulling out the Bible and getting a refresher course. So I always go to one of my books is the Tao Te Ching, that's Lao Tzu. People don't understand what that is. But when I grew up,
you know, Korshawn was on that too.
Yeah. Taoism. So I'm Taoist. So this chain I wear, this is Tao. But growing up as a Baptist, Christian, and then dibbling, dabbling into Masonic order, which takes you through every religion, and then coming back and then getting in a situation that was almost death, and some Shindaos approached me and was like, Jay, you better than this. I'm going to hand you this book. Before you do anything, read this book. And I pulled over on the expressway and read the whole book in like an hour. And it changed my complete life because it merged what I learned in traditional Kung Fu, and I can smash somebody. I'm for real.
Whoop Maul real quick. Let me see.
Whoop Maul.
Whoop Maul Ace real quick.
Y'all boy.
Well, hey, be careful now. Yeah. These hands. These hands.
He said on hands.
I know South Side.
He said,
I know. You're going to be doing all like,
yeah, okay, we got that too. We got that,
you know,
too. We got
that too.
But he just sent me something, Toby's guy, the DJ dude.
Oh, yeah, Reeks.
So he's Shaolin, and they just got a doctrine approved through Congress or something in Houston or whatever he was getting.
They just did.
I was like, oh, that's a blessing because now it's starting to come into the forefront about how these little philosophies that relate you to nature. Right, so you come back and you be like, oh man, how the lions get out with no TV, no propaganda? How the monkeys can do this with, if a monkey was born and his mama and daddy died, like how do he know what he's supposed to do and what to eat and what not to eat and who to mess with and who not to mess with? That's an instinctual, natural order that we lose because we're being constantly
programmed
with all the propaganda. Yeah. But that's a little bit about that. But that's how I go back. Every time I feel like I'm getting a little too far, Taoism bring me right back.
Yeah.
And what book was that?
The Tao Te Ching.
Tao Te Ching?
Tao Te Ching.
Tao Te Ching.
Sir, I ran it aside. Changed my life.
Oh, dude. Yeah, oh, you, oh, okay.
Yeah. Oh, you really went to jail.
My man, Lao Tzu.
You really did go to jail.
Oh yeah, Korshawn got a story, bro. Yeah. We did
the podcast.
Oh, okay. It ain't come out yet, but when it come out, man, y'all gonna Korshawn. He, man.
You probably the third African American person that I know that said they read the Tao Te Ching.
He doing.
We're about to be five or six of them.
Facts.
Nick just picked it up too.
I'm gonna check it out.
That's the foundation that I always go back and be like.
Dr. Johnny Mullins, let him know how to reach you real quick, big dog.
He might not
man,
be
well,
reached.
we got something happening. Should we talk? I don't know. Jamal might kill me.
What? Your social media?
The 120.
Oh yeah, we started 120 development. Yeah. So yeah, that's we started on. You can say that. See, I appreciate it.
Jamal got Johnny nerves.
We started. Hey, don't fair. Hey.
Yeah.
Like I said, like this.
We got 120 development. Don't get into detail on what we're doing. The major project.
Yeah.
But and I then, got. Where can they follow you?
So
right now I got the Instagram based on what Jamal gave me, and I got the shirt, so he don't change it again. But Dr. Developers University. The developer's developer. You gave me developer's developer.
Yeah, no, you got the doctor develop you or something.
Yeah, because they didn't have, because doctor
right,
developer's
so your,
developer was done.
Your social media.
So, so on Instagram, right, it's Dr. Developers U.
Right.
And is it Y-O-U or just
a U? Just a U. So D-R-D-E-V-L-O-P-E-R-U. Yeah,
Dr. Right.
That's
an IG.
Hey, man. Well, listen, you know, I'm sure you'll be back on, man. Appreciate you, man. Great story. I love,
Can we do a podcast?
I love hearing about different stories and how people came up.
Can we get back on the podcast again in the skyscraper?
Oh.
We can put it on the rooftop.
On the rooftop.
Yeah, yeah. No, in my penthouse that I already, that was part of my contract. You know what I'm saying? That part of my contract. So. Anyway, man, I appreciate you, Johnny. Straight up, man. Congratulations, bro, on everything. Look forward to, you know, seeing, you know, what's next. And, you know, just congrats, man. Congrats on your son balling out at Northwestern.
Yeah, man.
We got a hooper at Northwestern. Oh. We got to deal with him in the Big Ten. So, you know what I mean?
Michigan State coming up next.
All good stuff. We're going to be – I'm going to have to come check out the game.
We knocked out Purdue.
Yeah, y'all did. Knocked out Purdue,
And praying for my state boys. We're gonna turn it around.
That's right.
Late in the midnight hour.
It's turning.
We out of here, man. We love y'all. We'll see you next week.
Let's go.
I want you to focus on here right now. Don't you worry about when you get home. You concentrate on this opportunity. You don't worry about tomorrow. You concentrate on this opportunity with all your might, with all your soul.
Thank you so much for rocking with us as always, right? We don't take it lightly, guys. And we hope that we've provided transformation and not just information. We want you to become the best version of yourself, right? Make sure you check out the show notes to access all the important links and get your product discounts. Now, one favor we're asking of you, do us this favor. Make sure you subscribe and leave us a review on Apple Podcasts. We want to know your feedback and how we can serve you better. And if there's anyone that you think could benefit from listening to this show, please, I begging you, please share it with them. And remember, as E always says, if you want to succeed as bad as you want to breathe, then you'll be successful.